Hey, I'm ready. All right. Wow. Good afternoon or good evening. Early evening. Yeah. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Have a couple of, a few announcements. Just a couple. Lori just walked up and she says, hey, is our car locked? Now it is, you know. I said, I told her on Sunday because John Clausen came in. He says, you know, your car is unlocked. And I said, my car is always unlocked. He goes, well, I just put something in the front seat. Yeah, good, thanks. And he goes, but you shouldn't leave your car unlocked. I said, it's Grass Valley. It's against the law to steal. You know, we're in a church parking lot. Stop it. I know better. But yesterday, my mother-in-law, my poor mother-in-law, she calls me and she's crying. She's crying so hard she can't talk to me because she's parked in front of Safeway and she puts her stuff into Safeway and, you know, in her wallet into the front, into her purse. And then she's going to put the card away because she's really nice that way. And somebody jumped in the front of her car and took her wallet. And she's just like, hey. I said, what did you say? Hey. I said, well, it could be a lot worse. And she's crying, how could it be worse? Why would God allow this to happen to me? Well, because we live in a fallen world, and there's haters out there, and there's people that do wrong things. And so you're a target. I was right there. Exactly. You're 89 in a white Cadillac with platinum blonde hair. You're a target. And you're 89. You can't do anything if you're right there except, hey! You know, so... Anyway, I got her laughing a couple times, and then I had a friend of mine take his truck and park it in her driveway last night because now dude has her address. So I said, okay, could you just go to my mother-in-law's and park your truck there for her so it looks like there's more than one person that lives in there. But anyway, it's 'tis the season. That happens, you know, so be aware of your surroundings. Pay attention. And that's my first announcement. Second announcement is we have baskets. They came in. They came in from, they're from Ghana, West Africa. Okay, they're up in Bolgatonga. These are called Bolga baskets. You see them hanging at Briar Patch and places like that. I checked out the prices at the local stores. These are fresh. They made these like 2 weeks ago. They sent me pictures. They finished them 2 weeks ago. They're pretty much indestructible. They come like this in the bag when you get them, okay? And then you just get them wet, spray them down with a little squirt bottle, and then when they dry, they stay that shape. Anyway, all these proceeds, and we're not selling them, we're giving suggested donation for missions. This is completely for missions, for Pastor Clement. Their village, I think it's like Obey, but it starts with a G, so I can never get it right. But it's outside the village of Zarungu, where the Fra Fra. And I've been in the marketplace several times, but one time the baskets were piled as they could have filled this room in the middle of that marketplace. Unbelievable. And I've checked out thousands of baskets, and these are the best quality. They are. I looked at the prices. These went from anywhere from $60 to $75 locally. So we're suggesting the suggested donation for missions is $50. And so you can see Kim back there. We only have 80 of them. So if you have to take two or three, that's okay. Anyway, that's for they've built and we've seen the pictures and these are elephant grass, and these are goat leather handles. Covered, and these are free-range goats, okay? They're free-range goats. When I was over there, I never saw a goat tied up. They just run around. They're happy goats. So that's from a happy goat. And they don't let anything go to waste. And they send us pictures of the clinic that they built, the school that they built, the church that they built. Yeah, and he buys goats for every widow in the village. And then he buys all their medical cards for the widows and the people in his village, and it's simple. And then, you know, he named his church Simple Truth Church, Obey, and named his son after me. But I told him not to do any of that. You know, we'll just take care of him, but here we are. Anyway, it's just great to be here with you as a family, and we'll get right into this. We'll have church same time, same station on Sunday morning. But we're going to celebrate the birth of Jesus today. And so that's what we came to do. So that's what we'll do. Heavenly Father, we're thankful that we're here. Absolutely gorgeous evening that we could come together and celebrate the birth of Christ. Lord, we're excited. We're excited because even though sometimes it doesn't feel like Christmas, we can come here as a family and it is Christmas. And Lord, we're going to spend this time to just bring that to the forefront. And I pray if anybody doesn't know you, that after this evening, they'll at least have something to ponder. And so, Lord, we lift up this time to you, and we just pray that you would be glorified and that we would just be glad and happy and hopeful because of our relationship with the true and living God. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Away in a manger, no crib for us.
Wow. Good job, you guys. That makes me jump every time, the first time you say shout. Yeah, you did great. That was a good time. Right on. Well, no human has ever attracted so much attention. No human that's ever lived on the planet has attracted so much attention. No person who's ever lived has had every word scrutinized and had his every action examined and considered everything that he did or debated everything he did, such as not Donald Trump. Jesus of Nazareth. I know that's what you were thinking, though. But Jesus of Nazareth, you know, when it's amazing that here 2,000 years later, 2,000 years after his death, after the birth of Jesus, crowds of people all over the world tonight, all over the world, crowds of people are they're packed into places or they're in places, gathering in groups in various sizes within COVID mandates, right? They're all over specifically to think about his birth. Specifically to think and consider the birth of Christ. So 2,000 years ago, after his death, crowds of people all over the world are coming together to consider his birth. It's amazing to consider that the creator of the universe, the eternal God, came to dwell with us as a baby, as a man. The creator of the universe, he poured himself into being a man. He put on humanity. The Lord of heaven came to live on earth. And so this birth is so huge that it became the high point of history. It was the pinnacle of history. In fact, we know that all history before his birth is BC, before Christ. All history after, since his birth is AD, Anno Domini, which is a Latin word for the year of our Lord. And so the birth of God in human form then is the most important moment in history. Luke describes this great event. I'm going to read it from the New Living Translation this evening on the birth of Jesus. Luke 2, 1 through 14. It says, at the time the Roman Emperor Augustus decreed that a census should be taken throughout the Roman Empire. This was the first census taken when Quirinius was governor of Syria. All returned to their own ancestral grounds to register for this census. And because Joseph was a descendant of King David, he had to go to Bethlehem in Judea, David's ancient home. He traveled there from the village of Nazareth in Galilee. He took with him Mary, to whom he was engaged, who was expecting a child. And while they were there, the time came for her baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn son. She wrapped him snugly in strips of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no lodging available for them. That night there were shepherds staying in the fields nearby, guarding their flocks of sheep. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared among them, and the radiance of the Lord's glory surrounded them. They were terrified, but the angel reassured them. "Don't be afraid," he said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior, yes, the Messiah, the Lord, has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David. And you will recognize him by this sign. You will find a baby wrapped snugly in strips of cloth, lying in a manger." And suddenly the angel was joined by a vast host of others, the armies of heaven, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in highest heaven, and peace on earth to those with whom God is pleased." Wow. Wow, we talked about that last Sunday, how amazing that must have been. These guys, it's just a night much like any other night in Israel. There's no real celebration going on by anybody, and a child is born. And it's a night much like any other night, but it was not a baby like any other baby. And this baby was the Lord Jesus. This was God and man brought together in oneness. Now, everybody in Israel knew things about the Messiah. Everybody in Israel knew the Messiah. He was going to come as king, and that he would come and he would be in the line of David. They knew that. and he would reign on a throne in Jerusalem, and he would establish his glorious kingdom of Israel, or for Israel. And they knew some things about the Messiah, and one thing that was absolutely clear to them that they would know about was recorded by the prophet Micah about the Messiah. Micah 5:2 says, "But you, O Bethlehem Ephratah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth to me one who is to be the ruler of Israel, whose coming forth is from old, from ancient days." So the Jews all knew the Messiah was going to come, and that the Messiah was going to be born in a little village called Bethlehem. At least that's what the Old Testament told them. So they knew that. And things don't happen by accident. Things are happen by the providence of God. And I love that whole analogy about God sees all of history like the parade. You know, like it's the Rose Bowl parade. And the Goodyear blimp is over the top. And the Goodyear blimp sees everything from the beginning and everything to the end. And so God sees that. He sees all of humanity. He sees all of our life. He knows everything about every heart that's in the parade. And he can see how things are lining up. I can remember that when I was a new Christian, and we heard the story about Easter, and I you know, how Judas gave up Jesus, and how they were allegedly friends, and then Judas gives him up for 30 pieces of silver. And so I asked the pastor after I heard it. I said, "So God created Judas to give up Jesus so his story would work out? So that's what Judas's whole thing in life was, is he was created to give up Jesus?" And he said, "No." And he talked about it's part of the parade. He sees it. It's his providence. And he sees what's going on. And he sees Judas's heart. And he knows Judas's heart. And he doesn't let in his economy let anything go to waste. Nothing goes to waste in God's economy. He uses it all. Okay, so he sees Judas's heart. And so he sets it up in providence. He sets up the parade to where it's going to work out, to where he can use Judas as the pawn, because that's where his heart is. And so you look at this, and nothing happens by accidents in this story. It's the providence of God. There's no such thing as a coincidence with God. There's no such thing as an accident with God. There's no such thing, you know. So had the emperor Augustus made a decision 1 week earlier, maybe he made a decision 1 week later, or any other time, if he'd have decided to do the census any other time, Jesus wouldn't have been born in Bethlehem. But he was. And God knew how long it was going to take, all the logistics that would have to be put together for the registration. And, you know, and he knew it was all about the money, right? It's all about taxes. He's going to figure out how he's going to make more money off the people, so you're going to have to all get registered. God knows all that. God knew that Herod would be resistant. God knew how long it would take for Joseph and Mary to travel their way 85, 90 miles and make their way up to Jerusalem. God knew exactly how long it would take so that they would be there for just a few days. But in those few days, there would be a baby that would be born. Every single detail was in the hand of the Almighty God. We can look at that in our own lives. We may not realize it, but even the little simple details, every single detail is in the hands of the Almighty God. And God still directs history. He still holds every king, every president, every ruler in his hand for his own purposes. Okay, so we're going to fast forward 33 years from the birth of Jesus to shortly after his arrest. And several hours before his death, Jesus makes a statement about Christmas in John 18. We're going to consider that right now. The situation is that Jesus and Pontius Pilate, you know the story. If you don't, I'll tell it to you. Okay, here he is, there, Pontius Pilate and Jesus, they're in the Roman praetorium, and Pilate's trying to, he's jamming up Jesus. He's talking to him, he's trying to get him to say something that would incriminate him, that would show that he was worthy of crucifixion. In verse 33, John 18, it says, Pontius Pilate says to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" And Jesus answered, "Do you say this of your own accord, or did others say it to you about me?" I love Jesus. Just for some of the stuff he's, I mean, I would have loved him, but he would have fired up every defense attorney he ever sat in front of. Because he never answers a question. But he answers the question. Are you the king of the Jews? Do you say this of your own accord? Or do others say this to you about me? And Pilate answered, am I a Jew? Your nation and the chief priests have delivered you over to me. What have you done? And Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would have been fighting that I might not be delivered over to the Jews. But my kingdom is not of this world. In John 18, 37, and then Pilate said to him, so you are a king. And Jesus answered, you say that I'm a king, and here it is. For this purpose I was born, and for this purpose I have come into the world, to bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth listens to my voice. And Pilate says, what is truth? And you could probably think, Jesus, he doesn't say it out loud, but he's thinking, I'd tell you, but you can't handle the truth. I could explain it to you, but there's no way you would understand it. And these words were spoken at the end of Jesus' life, but they were about Christmas. For this reason I was born. For this reason right here, there's Christmas. Christmas exists because Jesus came to bear witness of the truth. And the testimony of his work, the testimony of his words is preserved in the Gospels for us. And if we read them, if you read your Bible, and if you need a Bible, if you're out there in media land, social media land, and you need a Bible, then you go and message us behind the scenes, and we'll send you a Bible. And you can read objectively, and you'll know the truth. And he came to bring the truth. And we will, as Jesus said, know the truth, and the truth will set you free. You know, it's funny how, I don't know, it's not ha-ha funny. I guess it's ironic or it's whatever. You know, if you know my background, a little bit of my background, I'm not a real emotional kind of guy. I'm not a real soft kind of guy. I'm kind of, you know, accused of being a meanie by my wife sometimes, you know. Not to her, of course, but to other people. But man, there's some things that just get me emotional, you know, patriotism or, you know, talking about the people that we pray for on Sundays, you know, that are in the armed forces, those kind of things. Or when I'm talking to you about the gospel and I say, hey, if you need a Bible, we'll send you a Bible. And I start, why do I get emotional? Stop, you know, but I guess it's because I'm getting old. I don't know, but here it is. Bottom line is, at Christmas time, there's all kinds of gifts. You can think of all kinds of gifts. They come to mind. But God's gift to us is Jesus. And that's the greatest gift that we could ever have. That gift is beyond description. And it's exactly what we need. A Savior for sinners. And we're all sinners. We have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And he came to save us. And we can have the gift of salvation and know God's peace by believing, by having faith in the promises of God, by believing and having faith in the promises of Christmas. And so as Paul the Apostle, he prayed, may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing. And when we do trust the promises of God and have joy and have peace and love, then God is glorified. God loves that. God, it says, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men with whom he is pleased. And you know with whom he is pleased? People who would believe. People who would believe. So if you're with us tonight and this Christmas is a time of joyous celebration, then God bless you. I'm glad you're here. What a wonderful blessing. It's awesome. But you may be here tonight, and it's not such a joyous Christmas. But like Paul the Apostle said to the Galatians when he was talking about Christmas, he said in Galatians 4, verses 3 through 7, but when the fullness of time had come, when the parade was in the exact spot, God's perfect timing, when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who are under the law, so that we might receive adoptions as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. And then we know John 3:16, for God so loved the world, and you've been loved. But when's the last time you were so loved? God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. And you think about that, you know, you think about, okay, Jesus is the light of the world. He's light. So what's light comes in and exposes the darkness. It comes into the darkness. It blows darkness up. And so what darkness does blow up? It's the darkness in our own lives. When we believe and we have faith in Jesus. And I was thinking about the D's on the way down here. I mean, you could be depressed or discouraged or discomforted, or, and you could think there's a bunch of them. I thought of a lot more when I was driving down the road, but I was thinking that's what he shines the light on in our lives. That's what he does when he changes our lives. And that doesn't mean we're not going to have any of that or all of that when we're Christians as well. We're still going to have that, but we have victory in those things. And if we believe that, then what's really cool is if you can believe that today and you've never believed that before, you've never accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you had a personal relationship with him, and you think, what's a personal relationship with God? Well, you don't even realize what it is until you spent time in that Bible, and then God reveals himself to you, and then one day you just go, oh my, I can have a personal relationship with God. I can. I do. I know him, and I feel like he knows me. And if you believe that, then may God bless you too as you celebrate by faith. And you believe someday that you're going to celebrate Christmas in heaven with the rest of us. Jesus is faithful to complete the work that he's begun. Also, in Isaiah, what Isaiah 53:3 says, that Jesus was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. So whether joyous or not so joyous or any place in between, Jesus is with us. Jesus is with you. Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. And so you look back to Galatians 4, and where Paul says, he says, because you are sons, because of faith, because you believe. All you do is believe and receive. You are sons. God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So we can, because of Christmas, we can cry out. We can say, hey, Daddy, help me. We can say, Daddy, help me. It's like, wow, that's what Christmas is all about. That is what Christmas is all about, that we're all in the family and Jesus can relate to us. And he dwells within us, and we have a relationship with him. And we say, wow, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas. Let's sing. Okay. Right on. God bless you.
Oh, come all ye faithful. Holy infant, so tender and mild. Christ was born.
Good job, choir. That was great. So if you haven't received that free gift of eternal life, then realize you're a sinner. We all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. recognize that it's true, that Jesus is who he says he is, and that he came here like he told Pontius Pilate. He says, I'm going to come here and I'm going to show you the truth. I'm going to tell you the truth. This is it. And so the truth is that Jesus is real, that Christmas is real. And so we believe that, and then we just repent, and repent just means to turn from the way that we were living. We're just going to follow Jesus. It's as easy as that. There's no prerequisite then other than faith. There's no, hey, I got to get my life all together first, or I got to change a few things up first, or, you know, I'm too much of a sinner. There's no prerequisite to believing, you know, and then and having faith and receiving that. Because then if you repent, what happens is Jesus changes your want-tos. From the inside, he changes your want-tos. There's things I used to want to do. I didn't even have to worry about it because he changed my want-tos. I don't want to do them anymore. There's still some things I want to do, and I don't do them because he changed my want-tos. It's really cool that way. So then we receive that free gift of eternal life, have the best Christmas ever. Heavenly Father, I thank you. I thank you for this group, this gathering right here, Lord, that's family, and then we got together. And Lord, I just pray if there somebody came in here tonight and wasn't family, that they are now because they believe. And so, Lord, I pray and ask in the name of Jesus to pour out your grace upon grace upon grace upon these homes, upon these families. Pray that they would be safe this Christmas. That you would give them safe travels this Christmas as we celebrate Christmas. And Lord, also that we would stay safe COVID-wise. And so I just know that you're bigger than that. I pray that you just go before each and every one of us. Keep your hand upon them. Keep us covered. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys. Have a great Christmas. Thanks for coming out this afternoon. If you need anything, we're still available. Just call or text the church and we'll get it dialed. God bless you guys.